Mes réactions, si c'est très, si monsieur, si, n'est-ce pas, vous savez que les Nations Unies portent toute la responsabilité.
He says that the United Nations carry the whole responsibility.
De toutes les massacres.
For all the massacres.
Pas reconnaître, mais ils portent la responsabilité. Les faits sont là, ils nous ont attaqués.
The fact is there and we were attacked, he says.
Surrounded completely for about 8 days. We fought only self-defense. The Irish troops here, and I think the job of all the United Nations is to keep the peace with the minimum use of force. And we did that. We fired only in self-defense.
Pat Quinlan, day and night, not just in the siege as it became known of Jadotville, but as prisoners, day and night, he was being called upon. And he never, never backed down. I think every man in the unit felt that he was badly treated in view of the heroic attempts that he made on everyone's behalf.
No Irish soldier since the Civil War had been in a position of such responsibility. There were no books. There were no manuals, there was only his own integrity, and to do exactly what he thought was best for the men he was privileged to command. I think his actions in Jadotville were most commendable.
I mean, you have to remember, my father was 42 years of age at that time. He was quite a religious man, a tough man, but religious man at the same time. And he saw more than just a Jadotville situation. I remember in his letters, he said, we didn't come out here to be killing African people. He said, we came out here to help them. So while he was a very good commander, and they certainly killed a lot of the enemy, he didn't see that as his mission. And he certainly didn't see it as his mission to lose his men.
Dressed in their very best. Indeed, they couldn't wait to start the jubilations. Perhaps these were in the nature of a dress rehearsal. Anyway, the people put on a good show.
In 1960, a brave new world is ushered in as the colonial powers give up their colonies around the world. In June, the Congo celebrates independence after 75 years of Belgian rule. Days later, Belgian interests were threatened when Congolese soldiers rebelled against their white officers. Belgian soldiers reoccupied the country and brutally crushed the mutiny. Congolese Prime Minister Patrice Lumumba called on the United Nations for help. Secretary General Dag Hammarskjöld dreamt of transforming the UN into an instrument for resolving international crises. Optimistically, he saw the Congo as an ideal opportunity to show what he could accomplish. UN peacekeepers poured quickly into the Congo and Belgian troops withdrew, except from the wealthiest province, Katanga. With Belgian encouragement and support, its president, Moïse Tshombe, declared independence, backed by mining company Union Minière.
It would be understood that were the United Nations to act as proposed, the Belgian government would see its way to withdrawal. it follows that the United Nations force would not be authorized to action beyond self-defense. It follows further that...
Hammarskjöld managed to persuade Tshombe to allow UN troops into Elizabethville, Katanga's capital, and the Belgian army officially withdrew. But hundreds of Belgian soldiers remained behind to run Tshombe's army. When Lumumba tried to invade Katanga with Soviet support, the CIA paid Army Chief Colonel Joseph Mobutu to overthrow him and dissolve parliament. The UN did not recognize Mobutu and now took over the immense task of running the Congo and restoring law and order.
France, Lebanon, Liberia, Mexico, Soviet Union, United Arab Republic.
Number of members voting 82.
United Kingdom.
Majority required 41.
United States.
And the result of the vote, Boland of Ireland, 46.
I should only like to say that I assume the duties of this office with the deep sense of obligation and responsibility which extends in equal measure to every delegation in the Assembly.
Ireland's objective in joining the UN was to pull herself out of her post-war isolation. In September 1960, an Irish diplomat was elected president of the General Assembly. The Congo operation gave the Irish government and people the opportunity to feel that they were playing a role in world affairs. Over the next 4 years, over 6,000 Irish troops would serve there.
What is Irish public opinion like at this moment, sir?
The public opinion in Ireland is in favour of the Congolese people getting a chance, and that they should be allowed to find their feet, and that people shouldn't be trying to make trouble for them for their own reasons.
Two Irish battalions of 1,300 soldiers embarked on US troop transporters and flew into a situation fraught with uncertainty and danger. Just weeks later, the Irish suffered their first casualties. In Katanga, an Irish patrol was massacred at Niemba by Baluba tribesmen they were there to protect. The Irish army received a harsh lesson in the realities of peacekeeping in the Congo.
Well, going out the first time, we certainly didn't know what we were getting into. And I don't believe the officers knew either. The second time we went out, we weren't as innocent. We knew that things were a lot different now, and that's why Commandant Quinlan had all this special training in Athlone, which you wouldn't normally do.
I found him to be very abrasive and a difficult man to deal with, and I had no empathy with him, not he with me, because he was always demanding the highest possible standards, and very often in my case, my platoon and myself didn't measure up, particularly in the question of anti-riot drill.
He had drills for instance, if we were suddenly attacked, what we were going to do and what our replies would be, and he would have us on trucks travelling along and suddenly declare an emergency and we'd be flying off the trucks and throwing grenades and shooting in all directions. His idea there was to have an immediate response.
Ireland's UN role received a further boost with the appointment of Lieutenant General Sean McKeown as Supreme Commander of the United Nations peacekeeping forces in the Congo. He left for Leopoldville, the capital of the Congo, in January 1961.
Thank you. General, you've just come back from a comprehensive tour of your troops in the Congo. Are you satisfied with the military situation?
Yes, I returned on Tuesday evening last from a week's tour of units in the Congo. I haven't seen all of them yet. Generally speaking, I'm satisfied. I'm satisfied with the spirit and morale of the troops I've seen. The overall military situation is a much wider problem, though.
The eyes of the world were focused on the Congo when ex-Prime Minister Patrice Lumumba was killed in Katanga by Tshombe, with the involvement of Mobutu and Belgium. Watching UN soldiers did nothing. Their instructions were not to interfere in internal Congolese politics. Lumumba's murder was the defining moment in African history, when the continent was welcomed into the Cold War. But the real conflict now was over who would control the continent's vast mineral wealth, the old colonial powers, the US, or the Soviet Union. There were calls for the UN to leave the Congo.
The speech is interrupted by a well-organized demonstration in the gallery. But Hammarskjöld stands firm, refusing to bow to communist pressure. His contention that disaster would result if UN troops leave the Congo is backed both by President Kennedy and by...
A new resolution was passed calling for the expulsion of foreign military personnel and political advisors and a restoration of Congolese unity. It was clearly aimed at Tshombe and his Belgian supporters. The mandate was strengthened to allow for the use of force by UN troops to prevent civil war, as a last resort. Nothing happened for several months until the appointment of Conor Cruz O'Brien as UN Special Representative to Katanga in July 1961. He arrived in Elizabethfield, the capital city, with the belief that Katangese independence was a threat to the existence of the UN.
Doesn't that in fact mean crushing President Tshombe?
Not necessarily individually. One could imagine President Tshombe coming to terms, as I believe he would come to terms, if the mercenaries were removed and if the UN was sufficiently... if he were convinced of the UN's determination to reunify the Congo.
Any attempt to disarm regular units would be met with 100% resistance. United Nations troops would have to make a war of conquest of colonialist type, which is against the principles of United Nations. In any case, the United Nations would need more troops than it could ever obtain.
Jeg berg mine til viki i mle klie som må dogeder vi prøyder le he gifigi og sajduri en tjokko jo kahan. Tjimpel hui kjeit færre vår sjål og sånne ikke tisjokk og særi eller rilte sje færre. Is the Gede Echelon War of Globemasters is holding that the Taras Father go Leopoldville to Congo le Lianacht go Yaw Abbert na Shihona. Se galan sjö ta sajduri as kamplacht A, kanas in Yirher, kamplacht B, kanas in Jeskert, agus kamplacht C, kamplacht Trainala an Chori.
We were proud of my father, of course, going out in that position as a company commander. It was a big thing in the neighborhood. But he wasn't the only one. We lived in an area in Athlone where you had a lot of officers, NCOs, men. All the people that were with my father, most of them were from Athlone, and they all lived within, I'd say, half a mile of where we lived.
The first time I saw Commandant Quinlan, and he was Commandant at that time, I was shortly after joining them and I didn't know how to salute. He was the first man to show me how to salute an officer. And from that moment, I knew that man had a big heart. I had respect for him.
When the opportunity came for to volunteer for overseas service, I jumped at it, naturally enough. Every young soldier did. And in June 1961, I was one of the 35th Battalion that headed for the Congo. My first time ever to see an aircraft, never mind flying one. I never saw one before.
And I just wanted to get out there for, I suppose, like all the lads, a bit of adventure. See what the world was like. I'd never been on a plane before. I'd never been out of Ireland before. And I suppose neither had about 90% of the company. I'd never seen outside of Ireland.
You could put armor carried into the belly of Sotio. And one of them was never lost. We landed in Wheeler's Air Base in Tripoli for a refuel going down and off again down to the Congo. mind you, me, you'd know you're in it with the hair.
The heat was unbearable as soon as we walked down off the plane, because we were dressed in army uniform, bull's wool, for the roughest of winters, not for tropical wear. So it was a very, very, very severe heat. Very hard to breathe.
Well, it was very stressful on soldiers having to do duties and carry weaponry, because your weapons was hot too. Your guns was hot. Hand grenades in particular, because they drew the heat and they seemed to be dangerous.
God bless us. If you put your arm on a bonnet of a car around 2 o'clock in the day, you'd stick to it. Unreal. It was 46 feet times. Unreal. And when it was raining, it didn't rain. It was like a river running out of the sky.
The conditions in relation to where we were posted, the billeting arrangements, in other words, were not good. And indeed, it was quite obvious to all of us that the Irish were not getting the best pick of the available lodgings.
No electricity, no running water, and no latrines. So it was an eye-opener for young soldiers to go into a situation like that.
Well, you didn't. We had rice and we had corned beef and powder spuds. I don't know if you ever see them. Terrible yolks. But they'd fill a hole in your belly, that kind of thing. And peas. I think every pea in Europe was in the Congo.
The whole of Katanga is on a plateau, flat as a table for hundreds of miles all around, with small stunted trees and elephant grass 5 to 6 feet high. Slow-moving, twisting, dark green, muddy rivers winding their way to God knows where. It is a featureless and uninteresting sun-baked land with clouds of red dust from the hard red earth. It is now midwinter, sometimes very hot, sometimes cold enough, especially at night. There is nowhere much to go at night except a few parties. It is not recommended or safe to go anywhere else. I'm writing this in my room and I have all your photos here in front of me. And I have a drop of whiskey beside me. So here is good luck.
It was a peacekeeping mission, of course, and at that stage in Katanga, which was the wealthiest province in the Congo, they wanted to be segregated from the rest under Maurice Tshombe and the Belgian masters that he had. And the UN decided that they were not going to be allowed to break away and take the wealth of the Congo from the rest of the population. And of course, there was faction fighting between different tribes. The Baluba comes to mind immediately, the Baluba Kasai people. And we were there to sort of be a buffer between them and to keep the peace, which looked like working for the first month or two.
Since he declared Katanga independent of the rest of the Congo, Tshombe has been busy taking lessons in how to project his personality. He's trying to present himself as the father of the people. It's slow work in Katanga's complex tribal society.
All senior officials in Katanga were Belgian. The province had 35,000 whites who enthusiastically supported Tshombe. The Katangese army, or gendarmerie, was run by white officers, mostly Belgian, with a sprinkling of French mercenaries. Without these, he could not maintain his succession, and the UN saw their removal as its prime objective. Hammarskjöld's policy was to seek a peaceful solution, with the threat of military force only to be used as a last resort. Once settled in, Quinlan continued the training regime he'd pursued in Ireland, adapting it to the new terrain and pushing the men relentlessly. He was determined that they should be proud of being UN soldiers. Indian Brigadier General Raja took over UN forces in Katanga. His arrival with a brigade of Indian soldiers brought a willing ally for O'Brien, who favoured a tough approach to Tshombe and was prepared to stretch the terms of the UN mandate to the absolute limit. Brigadier Raja was impressed with Commandant Quinlan's dispositions when he reviewed A Company and praised him to battalion headquarters.
Commandant Quinlan was insistent that we would exercise and train on a very regular basis. And again, unfortunately, I could never measure up with my platoon to Commandant Quinlan's standards. So much so that when eventually I got an opportunity to volunteer for a patrol to a town called Dilolo, which was on the Angolan border, I was delighted to get the opportunity just to be away from the tentacles of my company commander. Got to Dilolo, there was a fair bit of tension when we entered the town. We did find the native family, got them into a minibus, and then returned as quickly as possible back to Kolwezi. During that journey, we lost one of the armor cars, which broke down, crashed into a ravine on the side of the road. We also lost one of our trucks.
The UN lacked sufficient troops to police this vast country as big as Europe, with the result that they were spread too thinly. The obsolete equipment supplied by the Irish army was not up to the rigors of Congolese conditions. Transport continually broke down, and radio equipment often failed to work. Quinlan discovered that Raja and O'Brien were planning a major military operation. His soldiers would be caught out in the open, surrounded by hostile forces. With great difficulty, he got a radio message to the patrol.
Eventually, we got to Kolwezi. We thought we would overnight there, but we were told to get back to Elizabethville as quickly as possible. There was problems arising in the city.
The commander of the patrol, who was Captain Byrne, Dermot Byrne at that time, said, okay, we'll keep going. So we got back to Elizabethville about 5 o'clock that evening, to find that there was a military operation to take place the following morning of arresting the various Belgian officers in Elizabethville and the area.
In July 1961, in an attempt to restore state authority, the UN reconvened the Congolese parliament. Delegates, some brought at gunpoint, were locked up and forbidden alcohol and other distractions. They were not allowed to leave until they came up with a new government acceptable to the UN.
They were trying to get a political solution to all their troubles, and all the politicians, if you would call them politicians, were gathered together in the Luvenium. I was in charge of the cigarettes and the sweets and other things of that nature that the Congolese would like. Were under my control, and they were given chits, which they had to hand in to me and sign for their ration of goodies. And in that way, I met them all. They had to come up and sign the book.
After much effort, the UN did manage to get the Congolese parliament reconvened, and Mobutu handed over to Mr. Odula as prime minister of a new central government of national reunion. One of Mr. Odula's first acts was to pass an ordinance for the expulsion of all foreign officers and mercenaries from Katanga, and he asked the UN to help him in this. 4 days later, on August the 28th, the UN representative in Katanga, Dr. Conor O'Brien, set about this task of removing 512 white officers from the Katanga forces.
The task of our company, A Company, was to take over the gendarme headquarters, which was in the center of the city. And at this stage, I had never even seen the actual target. And my mission, particularly number 3 platoon, was to take over and set up roadblocks outside the gendarme headquarters.
And at 5 o'clock on that morning, on the 28th of August, this big palace came into view. And there was a couple of sentries at the gate, gendarme sentries, just they flew over there. And there was an armored car boat that went in the gate real fast. And I was in the Willie's Jeep. Flew in the gate too, jumped off the Willie's Jeep and entered the palace. Get in if you could.
Luckily enough, as we rounded the corner outside the gendarme headquarters, the sentries had disappeared. And very quickly we set up our roadblocks. And just as we were setting the roadblocks up, we heard the first bursts of fire. At that stage, Commandant Quinlan led the charge in an APC through the gates of the gendarme headquarters, and in the space of 15 minutes had captured the headquarters itself, plus the guard of approximately 30 Katangans. My own platoon arrested 4 Belgian mercenary officers, and one of them actually handed me his pistol when we arrested him as he was driving into the headquarters.
To our annoyed, one particular guy, my platoon commander, the late Colonel Joe Leach, was trying to question him and get his name, and he didn't want to give any information. So he had a Beretta pistol. So Joe took the pistol off him, and he was very annoyed about that. So eventually he gave his name and that.
But no one was killed in that engagement, and they gave in quite readily, and we captured all the Belgian officers as they reported in for work that morning, and later saw them being deported. But we didn't really see them as the enemy.
And I got an order to get one section of my platoon, that'd be 10 men, get onto a DC Dakota aircraft, fill it with mercenaries, and fly to Kamina, and handed them over to the 1st Infantry Group, an Irish unit in Kamina. All in all, it was a long day and it was a hectic day. Not one I'd easily forget.
An elated O'Brien sent a message to the Irish troops. I wish to express my profound gratitude and pride on the results of the action. The results were so spectacular that they have resounded throughout the whole world. Chomba, taken by surprise, broadcast his submission and announced the dismissal of all foreigners from his army. Before the operation was completed, O'Brien ordered a halt to the arrests under pressure from the consuls of the colonial powers.
That decision, which now appears wrong, was taken by me on my own responsibility in consultation with General Raja. It was taken following an engagement given to me by the Belgian Consul General, Monsieur Henri Crenaire, that if we would stop the forcible arrest of the foreign officers, he would see to it, Belgium would see to it, that they were repatriated immediately.
Raja insisted that remaining officers were to present themselves voluntarily at UN assembly centres within 2 days, or arrests would resume. Most Belgian regulars complied, but a hard core of French and Belgian mercenaries went underground. Jadotville, second city in Katanga, and 90 miles from Elizabethville, was home to thousands of white settlers, with a large gendarmerie training camp close by. It was also the headquarters of Union Minière, the giant Belgian-British mining company that bankrolled Tshombe. Raja ordered a UN force to set up an assembly centre in Jadoville. The Swedish commander arrived first, but decided that the mission was not feasible and made the decision to return.
I was the first Irish officer ever to go into Jadoville. When I got there with my platoon, which was about 36 soldiers, Meade was there to greet me, and obviously he had itchy feet, and he only had about 8 to 10 soldiers with him. All others had left. And he told me that we were in a very dangerous place, that we shouldn't be here, that's in Jadoville. And I asked him for a briefing, and he said, I've just given it to you, you shouldn't be here, it's dangerous. And with that, he mounted up in a vehicle and he left. And on the second night, quite a substantial mob, I would call them, of people came out from the town of Jadoville. Now, they were all white people, and they were very threatening to us. And naturally, we were armed, and we produced quite a number of troops who put on the gas masks and got gas canisters ready, because these people were very angry that we should be there.
In this group of prosperous Katanga businessmen, two are Belgians and two British. I wanted to find out what they thought about life in independent Katanga.
Before the United Nations troops arrived, we were in security.
You were secure before?
Yes.
Have they made any difference?
No.
Frankly, I don't think anything of the United Nations was. Well, we could really do without them.
Consequent to that, it was decided by Battalion Headquarters and Katanga Command that B Company, our company, should about turn the following day and go back to Elizabethville.
Stirred up by his Union Minière backers, Tshombe and his Interior Minister, Godefroy Munongo, orchestrated a violent campaign against the UN. They also began a vicious harassment of the anti-Tshombe Baluba tribe. 35,000 people left their homes for UN compounds, creating a humanitarian disaster. The white population was terrified of the refugees and also feared that the gendarmes would mutiny without their white officers. The Belgian consul pleaded for a UN garrison in Jadoville, insisting that the UN was now responsible for the protection of the white population. Under pressure from Belgium and Britain, Hammarskjöld ordered that the UN go back to Jadoville with this new mission.
We were brought out to Jadoville in trucks supplied by the UN. And all that was remained of these when they went back after dropping us in Jadoville was one broken down truck, two jeeps, one ambulance, and the company commander's car. As we moved around the place in our jeeps, as we went out to show the flag and to reassure the population, we were hindered at every turn by gendarmerie who had set up roadblocks. They also drove truckloads of troops through our position. And they could do that because the road ran through our position. Our position had been selected by a civilian United Nations person, not for any military advantage, but merely as a place to lodge.
When Commandant Quinlan decided to meet the burgomaster in the town and was told to remove himself and his company and UN from Jadoville immediately, and it was fairly obvious that the white population did not want us there and that we were not welcome.
So the first thing that was done as soon as we landed in Jadoville was to dig in. You know, because he must have, maybe he heard something or maybe there was rumours going about, I don't know. But
troops got more and more passing by, bigger trucks, more troops heading toward into Jadoville from Elizabethville. So they were building up troops all the time.
We could see the gendarmerie digging in around us. And I think at that stage there were several efforts to have us withdrawn, which were ignored.
My father became very much aware very, very quickly that the mission he was given in Jadaville was really not a good mission. And I know that he sent the doctor, Commandant Joe Cloon, and Captain Liam Donnelly back to Elizabethville to ask for maybe a different mission. I know that this was discussed with Cruz O'Brien, and the result was, anyway, they were told to stay in Jadaville. The mission hadn't changed.
We were about due to leave when a radio message came, well, don't come back, we're surrounded. And I think the most important thing that we took that time was a small truckload of pack rations.
In Elizabethville, tension between the UN and the Katangese reached boiling point. UN head of civilian operations in the Congo, the forceful Tunisian Mahmoud Kiari, came up with a plan of action. UN troops would take over Elizabethville and force Chomba to cooperate. Kiari gave O'Brien arrest warrants for Chomba and his cabinet.
As I understand it, Monsieur, from your account, Monsieur Fabry, the legal advisor, gave you a number of warrants of arrest. Did those warrants of arrest include one for Mr. Chombe?
They did, but this was only to be used if Mr. Chombe were unwilling to cooperate.
UN Secretary General Hammarskjöld was due in the Congo and was adamant that nothing be done without his authorization, but Kiari did not intend to wait. When Chombe rejected one last request to go to Leopoldville, Kiari gave the go-ahead for Operation Morthor. This time, he said, there were to be no half measures.
The gendarmes were patrolling on the hour by our camp, and our company commander told us to just act normal, as if nothing was wrong or nothing happening. So he had us digging the trenches at night, and we were annoyed over this and gave him a few swears. But little did we know how valuable those trenches were going to be to us.
At the radio station, the UN asked the Katangese guards by loudspeaker to leave, promising them they would not be disarmed. The guards refused. There was a bloody battle in which 24 Katangese and one Swedish officer were killed. Force is force, even when exerted by international police, and the fruit is bitter.
Although the Katangese were forewarned and waiting, the key buildings of Elizabethville were soon under United Nations control. Gendarme casualties were heavy, and Katangese morale wavering. The Indian UN troops at the radio station had killed all their prisoners with hand grenades. However, only one minister was captured. The others had already fled. Chombe called O'Brien to ask for a ceasefire. In return for a guarantee of his personal safety, he would announce on radio the end of Katangese secession. At 6:30, O'Brien called a press conference to inform the world that the secession of Katanga was over. But his statement was premature. Chombe's submission was the key to UN success, but they had failed to place a guard on Chombe's residence. The president fled to the British consul, who encouraged him to defy the UN. Britain, with her considerable financial interests in Union Minière, now became Chombe's principal champion, and the gendarmes began to counterattack, led by the remaining mercenaries.
Around 7 o'clock, or 700 hours, a call came from battalion headquarters in Elizabethville stating that Operation Mortar had taken place, all installations had been captured by the United Nations troops, and that to inform Commandant Quinlan to be on the alert.
5 minutes before they attacked us at mass, that's when he found out about Operation Mortar. And even then they didn't tell the truth. They said it was a complete success. My eye. Everyone in the country except us knew about Operation Mortar, including the gendarmerie, who were waiting for them.
You weren't prepared for it?
No, we weren't. We're men were at mass at this time, except a few fellas who were in the trenches for the normal local protection. Mass had just started, as a matter of fact, and firing broke out. About a party of other platoons tried to rush our position and fired, and they were driven off. That was our first indication of what really happened.
everyone was in their trenches and waited and waited and waited. So it was very quiet all over, an eerie situation. And then about 11 o'clock in the morning, it started.
I was a qualified mortar officer, so I knew exactly when I heard the first pops of the weapons being fired that they were actually mortars. And my reaction was I could not believe that we were being mortared. This was very quickly followed by the rattle of heavy machine guns. And very quickly then, our own troops went into action, firing Vickers machine guns, and firing the 60mm mortars in addition to small arms fire.
Would it be able to pull a trigger on a human being? That was my biggest worry. And of course, when the time came, you never even thought of it. It came automatic. If someone stopped up in front of you, if you saw a target, you shot and that was it.
Who's going to be the best man at the end of the day? That's how you feel. There's no in between. You just fight. But it is hard to shoot people that you have nothing against. It's very hard to do that. But there's no other way.
They were very brave men, these gendarmerie. They were rushing a defended position and they were not getting very far and they were suffering tremendous casualties, as we heard afterwards, which is not something anyone takes any pride in.
Within about 200 yards of our positions, they stopped and very, very quickly then started to withdraw and made their way back towards Janetville. Needless to remark, we were absolutely thrilled that we had beaten off this attack. We were highly elated, and the question was, will there be another attack? So we had to stay on the alert for the rest of that day, and in addition, listen to our colleagues being mortared and machine gunned up in number one platoon and support platoon areas.
We could see the movement of the troops and we're firing. Every time we saw somebody, we'd fire on them. And unfortunately, I got shot then, about that time. I got shot through the thigh, went up across my thigh and up into my stomach, out the other direction. So, and as soon as I got hit, naturally enough, being foolish and inexperienced, I jumped up. And when I jumped up, I was hit from the front in the chest, just to the right of the chest. So the bullet hit the magazines and killed the power. So it didn't actually hit me, but it exploded all the rounds in the magazine. So that's how close I was to seeing no more action for that day or ever. And Commandant Joe Clone was the medical officer, and he cleaned out the wounds and he patched them up as well as he could. So the next morning I was able to hobble around, so I was back out again in the trenches and continue on fighting.
When the Secretary General arrived in Leopoldville that day, he was surprised to hear that the UN was attempting to end Katangese secession by force. The UN was at war, his worst fears realised. He took full responsibility and ordered O'Brien to locate Tshombe and bring the military action to an end in the shortest possible time.
Mr. Tshombe took refuge with Mr. Denzel Dunnett, British Consul in Elizabethville. Mr. Dunnett did not inform the United Nations. Mr. Dunnett said that Mr. Tshombe came to him that morning, 6 o'clock in the morning of the 13th September, when firing had already broken out. According to Mr. Dunnett, Mr. Tshombe sat there for 1 hour and they did not discuss politics. Mm-hmm. I'm still trying to believe that.
O'Brien and Raja ordered the removal of A Company from Jadoville, but General McKeown feared the Katangese would see this as a sign of weakness on the part of the UN and asked that they remain. Three platoons of Irish soldiers from B Company with two Swedish armoured cars were sent to Jadoville to reinforce A Company. When they reached the Lufira Bridge, 20 miles from Jadoville, they encountered determined opposition and launched an assault on the bridge.
First of all, we heard around 1600 hours, we could hear the mortar fire at the Lufira Bridge. We could clearly hear mortars and machine guns. And this fire lasted maybe an hour, maybe an hour and a half.
Suddenly it was decided by the commander that we would pull back and we would review the situation and we would make another attack at first light. That was the following morning.
Well, we were looking to see their heads coming over the hill any minute, but they never arrived. And I wasn't surprised because it was left so long.
And the following morning, it was decided at battalion headquarters that we didn't have sufficient strength, we didn't have mortars, etc., etc., that we'd come back, regroup, and a much stronger force would be put in position.
That night, McKeown and Hammarskjöld attended a dinner with the Congolese government. Hammarskjöld appeared calm, despite the storm of international outrage at the UN's actions. Although O'Brien's announcement of the ending of secession had severely embarrassed the UN, Hammarskjöld strongly defended the UN's actions, claiming that they were acting in self-defense. Gendarme attacks on UN positions intensified across Katanga as the UN went on the defensive. A Katangese Fuga jet bombed and strafed Elizabethville and Jadoville several times during the day, causing great destruction.
And we heard this screech of the jet itself as it descended, firing its twin machine guns at Porfina itself, and taking off right over the top of Porfina, and suddenly we heard the explosion of what transpired to be two bombs.
He ripped the ground asunder with cannon fire, and it all happened fast. The first bomb fell near a trench that I was in. Well, I was touched. I was buried. And my comrade was touched up in there.
Commandant Quinlan started to emerge as the real leader. And very quickly, he was everywhere. He was directing, he was encouraging. He tried to organise the two armour cars so that they could fire across each other if there was another attack. In other words, there would be some kind of anti-aircraft defence.
And they had Vickers machine guns on the turrets. And they aimed them so that when the jet flew in, as we expected him, he'd be caught in the crossfire. And indeed, he was.
At this time, he came again. He did exactly the same, but he came at the other side of Porfina, dropping two more bombs. The two armor cars opened up, but naturally, by the time they had actually tried to identify the aircraft, he was traveling so quickly that he was actually gone and on his way back to Kolwezi. But again, the fear of being attacked from the air was now a new concern for all of us.
In Elizabethville, the Katangese were beginning to make some headway against the UN. Mercenaries attacked an Irish patrol, killing two Irish soldiers and capturing the rest. An Irish outpost was cut off and 12 soldiers made prisoner. O'Brien requested reinforcements and fighter bombers. He still thought he could win.
Wow, What do you miss most?
My wife and kids.
And you? What's your name?
Sergeant Jeremiah O'Driscoll of the Curragh.
From the Curragh?
Yeah, married in the Curragh camp. We'll just keep your fingers crossed that we get out of here.
What is your name?
Patrick Bourne.
Patrick Bourne, from Dublin?
Yes.
And how are you being treated?
Oh, very well.
Are you getting enough to eat?
Oh, yeah, I'm getting plenty to eat. Different variety, you know, just like at home.
And how's your morale?
Oh, very well.
And how long do you think you're going to stay here?
Well, we haven't a clue about that, but we're hoping it'll be soon.
Now, night falls very quickly in the Congo. And when I thought it had fallen sufficiently, I got out of my trench. I heard four rounds of mortar fire being set off. And the next thing I knew was they were whistling over my head. And I realized that they were coming in my direction. I was probably the target. I thought I saw a slight depression on the ground, threw myself into that, covered my head, and waited for the first two bombs. And I was going to get out of there for the next two. I heard the two rounds going off quite close to me. Whatever length that was, I don't know. I jumped up immediately and ran like the dickens. And I heard the next two shots going off behind me, but I was 50 yards away at this stage. And then I realized that my legs were wet and that my trousers was flapping against wetness. And I looked down and I saw that I was bleeding from the legs. I was injured at nightfall. There was then a following nightfall, and the morning after that, found my weapon under my stretcher, that's what I was on, grabbed it and ran back to the trenches where I was kind of comfortable with my own men.
Quinlan continually tried to broker peace by telephone with his attackers. The response, for the most part, involved threats of massacre and cannibalism from the mercenary at the other end. Despite repeated promises from HQ in Elizabethville, neither reinforcements nor supplies were sent to A Company.
Everybody seemed to be busy and doing exactly what they should do. I mean, the obviously training that was there was all put into effect. First time they ever had to do it, but they did it extremely well.
The morning of the third day of fighting saw ground and air attacks on the UN in Elizabethville and Jadotville. The pilot flew at a higher altitude over A Company because of Quinlan's ad hoc air defences, and his attacks were less accurate. In Jadotville, conditions were deteriorating.
Then on, I'd say it's on Friday. It's hard to keep track of time when you're out in the middle there fighting. On Friday, the water was practically gone. You just wet your lips and the food was gone, and the ammunition was practically gone.
I realised for myself that at that stage I could only stand up for about 15 minutes would seem a long time. We used to spell ourselves on sentry duty, if you wish, but the time, at first we could do 2 hours, but as the time wore on, I know myself, I found it difficult to stand for more than 15 minutes before you nudged the chap that was trying to get a little bit of shut eye and tell him he had to take over. So we were on our last legs, really, towards the end. But I heard no one saying we should give in.
I often wondered, what in the name of God are we doing here? We have no war. We have no gripe with anybody. We're fighting somebody else's war. That kind of a way, but then again, I said, well, that's what you joined the army for.
But you didn't think about yourself. You always thought about your comrade. You'd always feel that nobody was capable of getting me, but somebody could get him. And you're never any good to a soldier until you see someone's blood. And when you see somebody's blood, your whole life changes then. And your whole world changes. And you're a different man when you're behind any class of a gun.
Hammarskjöld asked for jet fighters to bolster the UN's position. Ethiopia responded immediately with three aircraft, which would have swung the battle in favour of the UN. However, Britain withheld permission for the jets to overfly British colonies. Britain also tried diplomatic pressure on Hammarskjöld, which greatly angered him.
Our ambassador's already had a very useful talk with Mr. Hammarskjöld, and we've studied the report of that talk. And I shall carry on from where Mr. Ritchie's, our ambassador, left off, and I shall hope to see Mr. Hammarskjöld tomorrow.
Do you also hope to see Mr. Chomby?
Yes, I do very much indeed. I hope that will be possible.
Chomba was encouraged in his resistance to the UN by the support of Britain and the other colonial countries. Rhodesia was reported to have massed troops on her border with Katanga, ready to support him. A Katangese propaganda offensive was remarkably successful. False rumours of the deaths of 57 Irish in Jadoville were widely reported around the world.
The big problem was the information that came to us on the Friday evening, with the Evening Herald. Black Friday, we called it at the time in Athlone, because there was a power failure in Athlone. Lights were out. I remember walking through the streets of Athlone, having read the Evening Herald, which said that the company was massacred and the officers had been executed by firing squad. On the Saturday, many of the wives of the other officers came from Galway and other places to my mother, and all the wives were together in the house, and they were wondering how to proceed from there, and they were discussing about having memorial services for husbands that would never return, bodies that would never be probably return. It was kind of certainly a black day.
It was suddenly decided that I should go to the Congo, and I'm on my way.
At the moment, is there any question of the Irish troops being recalled?
No.
Now, when the Irish troops were sent out to the Congo, was it expected that they'd be employed on this sort of an action?
Well, it all depends on what you mean by this sort of an action. The whole United Nations action has been, for this last 14 months, to try and stop civil war in the Congo, try to give the Congolese a chance to find their own feet, and to discourage foreign intervention. That has been their object for the 14 months, and it hasn't changed.
Supreme Commander General McKeown prepared to come to Elizabethville. He sent Quinlan a message telling him that the men of A Company were heroes. He wanted A Company to hold out at all costs. The prospect of 156 more Irish soldiers as prisoners could destroy the UN's military reputation. At 9 o'clock, Commandant Quinlan finally received the news he was waiting for. A supply helicopter was on the way, and stronger reinforcements had left and would arrive at Lufira Bridge at 11 o'clock.
The helicopter came in from Elizabethville. We could see it clearly in the distance because it was white with the UN sign on the side of it. Paddy Neville, quartermaster, and Bobby Allen, who was the cook at that stage, rushed out with sheets to indicate where the helicopter could land.
We got a couple of blankets, actually, and brought them out and put them on the ground where he could land, and put a stone on them and got our bodies out of the way of them, and that to them come. Because if he came down, he could have come down the trenches or anywhere, you know, because they were all camouflaged and covered and all sorts of stuff. But he was very pleased over where we landed. We unloaded it, and everyone was looking for a sup of water, but you couldn't use it. And who's for? Somebody done a boo-boo by putting water into jerry cans anyway. But you couldn't even wash it with it because it was contaminated with different oils and diesel and all sorts of yokes.
The gendarmes had concentrated heavy fire on the helicopter, revealing their positions to Quinlan, who responded with accurate mortar fire, decimating the Katangese. The relief column drew near.
Now we had the mortars, and now we had an extra company of the Indian Gurkhas. That certainly buoyed up our morale. And we knew that it was going to be fought properly the second time. We gave the bridge a tremendous bombing, and we also gave their vehicle car parks. We obliterated them. And obviously, they were in a very difficult position because of the mortars. And also, they saw the Gurkhas moving forward on the left flank, while Jimmy Farrell and his platoon were moving on the right. And suddenly, they blew the railway bridge, which was on our left flank, because obviously they thought if the Gurkhas got across there, there would be no defenders left, I think.
The effects of Quinlan's morning fusillade and the relief column's attack on Lufira Bridge demoralised the Katangese, who mutinied against their white officers. The African mayor of Jadoville asked for a ceasefire.
A contingent marched out from Jadotville. About six people with a white flag. And our commanding officer, Commandant Quinlan at the time, went to meet them. And not alone did he meet them a few feet from the trench I was in, but he called on a half dozen fellows out of the trenches to present a guard of honour for them coming up the road.
All I was told was that we were going to form a guard of honour, that the mayor of Jadotville was going to come up that road and he was going to have a guard of honour, and that our officers and them, they were to meet and discuss some kind of a ceasefire that had lasted.
Mayor asked for ceasefire, agreed on condition that bridge garrison would also cease fire and that jet would be grounded. This was agreed to. We are getting water and food. We have not, repeat, not surrendered. Present arrangements will avoid heavy casualties on all sides. High-level talks can fix the rest. We are ready and waiting. Tommy der Fahre, agus Olaf.
And the gendarmes, of course, came along and they went inspecting our area. They were looking for bodies. And they wouldn't believe. And they kept asking, where have you buried your dead? And where have you buried your dead? And we told them we didn't have any casualties, major casualties. No one was dead. And they even got into the trenches and looked into the trenches for them, but they couldn't find them. They had heavy casualties. No, there was never a figure put on them, but they had heavy casualties.
Hello, Pat. This is the Commando C speaking very sincerely. And I know I speak for every officer, NCO, and man of the Western Command, that we are all intensely proud of you and of every member of A Company for the splendid show that you put up in Jadotville. I'd like you to convey that message to all members of the company. And indeed, not alone are we proud of you, but the Army and everybody in the country, you can take it for granted, is extremely proud of A Company, of the 35th Battalion.
We got the information by telephone that they were all okay. I jumped on my bike, cycled fast as I could down to Assumption Road, and of course they all came running out onto the street when I arrived. And just at the same time, a staff car arrived from Custom Barracks, and Commandant Owen Curtin was in this car. He got out. I left him do it, of course, to tell them about the situation. I remember there were tears in his eyes, so they assumed the worst and they were getting very agitated. But he said, let me catch my breath. And then he said, they're all okay. They're all alive. And, of course, great celebrations, women crying with relief, children jumping about, everybody hugging each other. But I remember that day and that incident very, very well. It's in my memory all the time.
Oh, Dad, this is Leo. We just got the message this morning that you're all right there. We're very worried altogether. Something I know that was on the paper today Commandant Patrick Quinlan, commander of the beleaguered troops in storm-torn Jadaville, an indomitable Kerryman, his cry of no surrender epitomizes the valor of all Irish soldiers. His weary little band, vastly outnumbered, continued to fight on with unflinching courage, undaunted by superior odds. I don't know whether you realize it or not, but the way the papers are here, they're all sort of, we were told that you were all massacred and that the whole lot of you were overrun and so on.
Hammarskjöld excitedly cabled UNHQ in New York with what he considered very important news. Gendarmerie troops in Jadoville have kicked out their white officers and are fraternizing with the Irish. Finally, he said, they seem to have got our point. Chomba had asked for a meeting with O'Brien in Rhodesia. O'Brien cabled Hammarskjöld that they should not meet there because it would accept the arbitration of the British. Hammarskjöld ignored O'Brien and decided to go himself. He felt that O'Brien was now part of the problem and had decided to fire him on his return.
Commandant Quinlan called a conference at about 2000 hours, at which I remember vividly him stating that we had performed heroically, that the company had fought tremendously well, congratulated all the platoon commanders and the NCOs and the men for the work they had done, but had to inform us that the relief column had again returned to Elizabethville.
The relief column had been attacked by the Fuga jet, with three killed and more injured. Attempts to cross the bridge failed. The commander of the relief column reported back to Battalion HQ, and they were ordered to return.
When you get an order in the army from the battalion down to the company, you obey it. The order was to about turn and go home. That's exactly what we did. We were surprised, to say the very least of it.
The lads at the bridge did their very best. Some of them were wounded, some of them were killed on the two forays they made on that bridge. And we know that, and we respect it, and we recognise their courage. They didn't succeed.
We had lost faith in our comrades, Swedes, Indians and Irish, that didn't make it. And if they didn't make it at the bridge, was there no blessed alternative than that one position, which was very well guarded, all right, I must say. But the area was a big area. We felt badly about that.
An uneasy ceasefire held throughout Katanga. The day was insufferably hot, and the men of A Company were finding the thirst almost unbearable. Quinlan radioed HQ that the ceasefire conditions were not being observed. There was no water, and during morning mass, the Fuga flew over. Godefroy Munongo, Minister of the Interior, arrived in Jadoville. Now was the moment of truth for Katanga and the United Nations, and Munongo was about to swing the balance to the side of Katanga. He summoned Quinlan to meet him.
After an hour, he returned, called a meeting of the officers and stated that Munongo had stated to him that the Irish troops had fought bravely, they had been honourable in their fighting, and that now he wanted them to cease fire and to stack their weapons, that they would be treated properly, but that they could not continue to remain in their positions.
Hammarskjöld was in a relaxed mood as he waited at the airport, confident that he could deal with Chomba as he had the year before. He was, after all, one of the world's most able negotiators, a man who commanded universal respect, even from his enemies. Chomba was also on his way, accompanied by the British consul. They were encouraged by the news from Jadoville. As he left, he read the final cables. By now, Hammarskjöld was aware of the changes in Jadoville. He knew that his job would be a lot more difficult now.
It is just as well the way things turned out. I was forced to surrender, but I had no other option. There was a choice of saving my brave men by doing that. There was only certain death in any further action. It could not be justified by any standards, moral, military, or political.
If we had ammo, we'd have stayed where we were. No. I firmly believe he wouldn't have budged. Only them always getting scarce. I mean, there have been 5 hard days and nights, and to be hard on ammo. Now, if the man in the helicopter brought it in full of ammo instead of water, it's quite possible we'd have stayed on.
What was left, hand-to-hand combat? After 4 days, 5 days in the trenches, I don't think we would have survived very long. We were totally outnumbered. So it was a proper decision. I firmly agree with it. We weren't happy, naturally enough, that it was surrender.
The Indy had to surrender, but he surrendered on his own, taking full responsibility for it. And as he said in that letter of surrender, failing to get any orders from Elizabethville. They left him to stew on his own, which was not very good. No orders given to him, which was an amazing military thing.
He was faced with a situation where the troops were tired, we had practically no water, ammunition was gone, the Vickers machine guns were out of action in the armored cars, and to try and break through back to the Lafira Bridge, which was 10 miles away, and then from there fight our way back into Elizabethville, which was another 50 miles away, would have been absolutely suicidal. He made the brave decision. It was not popular in many cases, but he made it, and he made it courageously.
It was the only decision that could be made at the time, the only one, if he wanted to save his troops and also to do it with honour. And he felt he was doing it with honour. And, you know, there were pawns in a chess game, and they came home alive, which is, in the final analysis, that is what matters.
I, Commandant Patrick Quinlan, Officer Commanding United Nations Troops in Jadoville, do hereby agree to the terms of surrender of Minister Monongo, because the Irish force is here in a peaceful police role, and any further action would result in the loss of African and Irish lives. In the absence of orders from higher authority, I take the responsibility for this decision.
He adopted the gruff commanding officer ways, but the mask slipped a little, and he told me that he had dedicated this A Company to the Blessed Mother before he left Athlone and promised to bring everyone home safe, and he was pleased that he was doing that.
Secretary General Hammarskjöld never met Tshombe. His plane crashed at Ndola at 2300 hours on the 17th of September. His body was thrown clear of the plane, the only one to escape without burns. But the tireless worker for peace was dead. Tshombe was shocked by Hammarskjöld's death. Surrounded by his allies, he went to pay his respects. He had emerged victorious. A Company was now at his mercy.
Convaincu que tous les efforts,
convinced that all the efforts
doivent être faits,
must be made
pour éviter d'autres pertes,
to avoid any further loss
de vies humaines,
of human life,
et en attendant qu'un accord définitif, les deux délégations
two delegations
ont discuté,
have discussed
et accepte L'accord provisoire.
And accept the provisional agreement.
Mes réactions, si c'est très, si monsieur, si, n'est-ce pas, vous savez que les Nations Unies portent toute la responsabilité.
He says that the United Nations carry the whole responsibility.
For what?
De toutes les massacres.
For all the massacres.
Est-ce qu'ils l'ont reconnu, les Nations Unies?
Qu'ils reconnaissent ou ne pas reconnaître, mais ils portent la responsabilité. Les faits sont là, ils nous ont attaqués.
The fact is there and we were attacked.
We were taken as prisoners and we disabled our guns, of course. I remember taking the bolt out of my submachine gun, which the guns, all the NCOs had, and hiding it. Hiding it in such a place I could dig it up later. Never got the chance. We were taken to a hotel and we were guarded by the gendarmerie. And we were supplied by food and water after we were in the hotel. They managed not to turn on the water, saying that the mains were damaged during the fighting. Well, we don't know whether that's true or not, but certainly I wouldn't have turned on the water to them if the positions were reversed.
Well, CSM, how long have you been a soldier?
Well, that is about 20 years, around 20 years.
Uh-huh. Now, well, how do you think your chaps behaved in the battle?
I think they behave tremendously, yeah. These lads are drawn from all over the Western Command at home, you see. I didn't know a lot of them before we came out here. But I can tell you I know them now. They behaved their first time under fire like veterans.
They showed such wonderful leadership that you couldn't but follow it. And that's, I suppose, if we had bad leadership, we wouldn't have been doing the things we were doing. So I think that the leadership was there and we were there to follow. And that's what happened. I would have went to hell and back again with Pat Quinlan and our NCOs.
I don't know, would I have enjoyed Pat as a social companion? It wouldn't have been my place to socialise with him anyway. But as a commanding officer, I'd go anywhere with him. And if he said fight on, I'd have fought on. No problem.
The Irish troops here, and I think the job of all the United Nations is to keep the peace with the minimum use of force. And we did that. We fired only in self-defence.
Mm. And what about your own casualties?
We had 5 casualties, wounded only. All the press reports, I'm glad to be able to deny them, of the 62 dead in Jadaville and 50 dead in Jadaville, which alarmed all our people at home. I'm glad to be able to tell them all that they were all false reports.
Our company commander, there's only one word can describe him, and he was simply dynamic. He was, his leadership, I don't think there's any to come up to it in our office. And I certainly hope that he'll be recognised. All our lads here, they're his slaves from now on.
A Company's capture was a bitter humiliation for the UN. A triumphant Chombe came to see the prisoners, but soon left as Quinlan formally complained to him about the breach of the ceasefire. With A Company as hostages, the UN had little bargaining power in the negotiations with Chombe and was forced to agree to his conditions, a return to the status quo before Morthor. A prisoner exchange finally came about after several false starts, and A Company was released, following 5 weeks of uncertainty and worry. In Elizabethville, Chiari watched as the UN pulled out of the positions they had occupied to the jubilation of the Katangese.
You don't know the temperament of them people. It could happen any time. You know, I think we were very lucky to get out of it. Because if they got a lock of this old drink and I hinted them at night, they'd think nothing, a shooting half of us at least, you know.
We all got out of it alive, which was sort of miraculous, and definitely down to Pat Quinlan and his tactics, and his foresight.
If I felt let down by anyone, it was by our own. You know, I thought they would have moved heaven and earth to get us out of the predicament we were in. I noticed that when we were eventually returned to the general body of the battalion in Elizabethville, in a farm called Russo Farm, that the ordinary chaps that you met, equal rank if you like, that they always spoke of Jadotville as a surrender, whereas they spoke of the retreats from the Lefera Bridge that included the Irish, the Swedes and the Indians as a withdrawal. Like Jadotville was a surrender, but the retreats from the bridge that was coming out to rescue us, that was a withdrawal. And that offended me. And there was a few fist fights back in the camp on account of that.
So it was business, back to business, and very little said about what happened, actually. I was surprised that a lot of people weren't too anxious to know what went on in Jadotville and what happened. They weren't really curious. I was surprised with that.
We were well received by the higher uppers. General Raja was there, and our own battalion commander, and several other dignitaries, including Mr. Connor Cruz O'Brien, God rest him. And we were brought off to a farm out of sight where we did some more training. And within the week, we had weapons issued to us again, and we're back on duty.
Now, Dr. O'Brien has complained of British and French influence in Katanga. Are his the views of most United Nations personnel out there?
Generally speaking, yes.
Are they your views, sir?
Generally speaking, yes.
Do you consider that Britain has had a harmful effect out there?
Not exactly in an official capacity, but British influences, shall I say, have had a harmful effect.
Mutant of Burma succeeded Mr. Hamashold to guide the UN during the parlous times it faces.
After a brief period of uncertainty and turmoil, a new Secretary General was appointed. Burmese politician U Thant got a new resolution from the Security Council, which allowed him to use force to achieve UN goals. More importantly, the US government had decided that Katanga should rejoin the Congo. American business interests felt that they were better served with a united Congo.
The bottom line is, if the UN pass a resolution, it's a world forum. It's the strongest forum in the world, whether you come north, south, east or west. Well, then if we are to have a rule of law in this planet of ours, we have to obey UN resolutions. We have no other choice except to throw in the towel and leave the UN.
I shouldn't say exactly that it is a turning point, but it's a clear indication that we have reached the stage where we've got to take strong action.
Do you have enough military manpower at the present time in the Congo, General McEwen, to put an end to the problems, the uprising? Can you stabilize the situation with the troops you have now?
Not with the troops we have at the moment.
Precisely what will you report to the Secretary General?
Generally speaking, I'll have to ask for more troops and more equipment.
The sooner they bring in paratroopers here, the better. The only way that this country can be ruled militarily is with paratroopers. On any stretch of a road, you can block an army for weeks. Few men would block an army for weeks, you know the type of roads here. And by the time they would be able to force their way through, it would be too late. The same has happened with us in Jadotville. The Indians are here supposed to be doing their duties, but they'll do nothing. But I have not yet had one complaint from any of my men. Not one complaint.
In December 1961, reacting to Katangese attacks on their troops, Raja and McKeown launched an operation to break the gendarmerie. The hesitation and timidity of Morthor was gone. They assaulted Elizabethville with air and ground troops, including Quinlan's A Company. There was heavy fighting all around the city.
But there were casualties. Civilians died. Not many. 40 Europeans. No one seems to bother to count the Africans. Slowly but surely, the UN tightened their grip on the town. All fighting ended on December the 19th, 1961, when Chombe accepted President Kennedy's offer to bring him and the central Prime Minister Adula together.
The day the fighting ended, Quinlan and A Company left the Congo. He had kept his promise to bring everyone back alive.
For me, at that time, 23 years of age, to be there, to be present at probably a unique stage in the history of the Congo itself, and to be part of a United Nations force, and the pride that that gave us, and also the fact that we were suddenly in a situation where we were working with other nationalities and we could judge ourselves as to how good we were. And we measured up tremendously well.
You know, everybody had changed in 6 months. My father was a bit surprised to find that I had outgrown him in 6 months. I was taller than him when he came back. I was smaller than him when he went out, you know. Little things like that I remember. He stepped off the train and looked at me and had to look up instead of looking down, you know. It was great to have him back, I must say.
Quinlan's recommendations for decorations for his men were ignored. None was awarded for actions in Jadotville. Far from being celebrated, the battle was to be forgotten.
But Jadotville was never spoken about in the army. It was a dirty word. They spoke about the Nyamba ambush, they spoke about anything that happened, but never ever, Jadotville was never mentioned.
People got very, very rough treatment because of Jadotville, and they were called cowards. They said they flew the white flag and the likes of that, and of course that caused a lot of trouble.
People think that because there were none of us killed, there was no fighting. It is a new slant on things for me. If you have men killed, you have a victory. But if you save your men and have a good defense, it is a defeat.
The Irish Army was a peacetime army, under-equipped, under-strength, yet when they started getting involved in the United Nations, bit by bit they started building up their expertise, their equipment, and now today, the Irish Army, out with the United Nations, is, even though it's small, I am told only very recently, is one of the best-equipped forces in the United Nations right this moment. So it was good. I have to say that being with the United Nations has been good for the Irish Army. I could see it myself when I was in the Army.
They're wondering what I'm going to sing, guys, but I'll sing something that five times we often talk to one another about, and we feel like sending out a request. I'm going to sit right down and write myself a letter and make believe it came from you. I'm going to write words oh so sweet. They're going to knock me off my feet. A lot of kisses at the bottom. Oh, I'll be glad I got 'em. I'm going to smile and say, I hope you're feeling.
Lovely, it is. Thank you.